It's going to be an amazing day. And I got to start last year, and I'm excited about starting our day off this year. And I want us to begin exactly like we did last year. I want us to make a few confessions as leaders to get on the same page. I'm going to ask you to repeat after me. And men, I would like for you to repeat after me as well and not sit back and evaluate, but to be drawn into the day and the information of the day. So if you would repeat after me, I may be in charge, but I don't always know what to do. On all our sides, number two, I may be in charge, but I don't have all the answers. I'm never the smartest person in the room. I'm just the leader. Isn't that, that's our little secret, isn't it? People look at us, you know, the discussion's over, the conference finishes, the decision has to be made, and they turn to us and they look, and they just assume that we've taken it all in and that somehow we're the smartest people in the room. And the dirty little secret of leadership is we always know there are smarter people in the room, and we always know there are better decision makers in the room, and we always know that we don't have all the information we need to make the best possible decision. That's why I absolutely love the theme of this day, and then you're in for such a treat. The theme for the day, as you know, is simply lead. Simply lead. The reason I love this theme is that I learned early on in my career that I was never going to be the smartest person in the room, and that the only way for me to move forward in life was to take complicated things and to make them simple. This occurred to me for the first time when I was in the eighth grade. In the eighth grade, I had a math class, and I don't remember exactly what it was, but it was, I'm sure it was like pre-something, okay? And so in this math class, I had a teacher named Miss Salyers, and we had our very first test. I was at Tucker High School back then. They put eighth grade into high school. I don't know why. And Tucker High School, and so I had my very first math test. Took my math test in whatever math class this was, and I got the test back. Some of you have been here. And there was nothing marked wrong on the test, but at the top of the test, it just said no. I made a no. I went home that day, and my mom said, "How'd you do on your test?" I said, "I made a no." She said, "A no?" I said, "Yeah, look, I didn't get anything wrong. Apparently, it was just so bad, Ms. Salyers just put no." Second test, got it back. Nothing marked wrong. No. So I thought, man, I need to figure out my grade in this class. So I knew that somehow it had involved division. I didn't know how to do that. So I said, "Mom, can you help me with this?" She said, "Well, I think no plus no is no divided by two. I think you got a no." So that's when I knew that academics wasn't going to be my thing. But I tell you what, for those of you who are B students and those of you who are C students, we do have a few advantages. One is this, we're not afraid to try things. All the smart people in the room talk themselves out of trying things. Us B and C students are dumb enough to try things and figure out how to make them work. I learned, so that's one advantage to not being the smartest person in the room. The other thing is this. In leadership, as you know, one of the most important things you can do is surround yourself with smarter people. And if you're a B or C student, that's easy to do. In fact, a couple of weeks ago, I was in California, and I had an opportunity to be on the platform with Jim Collins, and we've all read Good to Great, and hopefully Built to Last, and all of those other things. He in his discussion on level five leadership, he was actually talking about that in this particular conference, and he made a statement, and I don't know if this was a quote from the book. I don't remember this being in the book, but I thought it was a brilliant statement. And for me, this was extraordinarily encouraging. Here's what he said. He said, "Level five leaders have the humility to aspire to be the dumbest person in the room." Now think about that. Level five leaders, you've heard him talk about level five leaders, have the humility to aspire to be the dumbest person in the room. I thought, you know what? For people like me, it doesn't require humility. You just walk in the room. And some of you feel that way. And that's why, again, I think today's, what we're gonna talk about today is so extraordinarily important. Making leadership simple. Now, the reason this is such an important subject and the reason we're gonna kind of drill down on this today is this. If you are in a growing organization, either you've started a business, you're in a growing department, a growing division, a growing branch, a growing industry, you've moved into a new market and it's a growing market, you know this, wherever there's growth and wherever there's expansion, along with that comes complexity. It's unavoidable. Wherever there's growth, there comes complexity. Those of you who are parents, you understand this. You remember it was just you and your husband or you and your wife, pretty simple. Then you added a kid, you know, got a little bit more complex. Then you added two, you went man to man, remember? If you added three, then you went to a what? You went to a zone, right? Then you added four and you thought, what are we doing? And if you have friends that have five, six, or seven kids, you just look at the complexity of getting people's shoes on and getting them out the door. We have some friends, they have six children. A few years ago, we invited them over for 4th of July. And when they came over, Dave, my friend, said, did you know no one ever invites us over to their home? I said, well, look, there's nine of you. Who would do that? But you know this, and the same is true in your organization. Growth creates complexity, and there's no way to avoid it. But the problem is this, and you know this, that complexity is the enemy of everything. You can put anything you want to in that blank. With growth comes complexity. Complexity is unavoidable, and with complexity comes all kinds of things. But specifically, the enemy is this right here. Complexity is the enemy of clarity. And in any organization, whether it's a small organization, large organization, your division, your department, the new market you've gone into, you've just launched a branch, you've entered an industry for the very first time, wherever there is complexity is the enemy because it destroys and begins to erode clarity. And clarity is extraordinarily important. In fact, Marcus Buckingham, in his book, The One Thing You Need to Know, hopefully you've read that book, he argues persuasively that in business and in organizational life and in leadership specifically, clarity is the most important thing. It's the most important thing. And yet, in your career, in your division, your department, your business, whatever you do, as you grow, and you're gonna grow because you're leaders, as you grow, there's gonna be more complexity. And with complexity comes the potential for the loss of clarity. And if you begin to lose clarity in your organization, it begins to erode your ability, you know this, to move your organization, your department, your division, the people who've sworn allegiance to you. It's almost impossible to move the ball down the field. Now, this became very apparent to me. 17 years ago, 18 years ago, we launched a church in this city, and I was with a group of people, and we knew that it was gonna be a really big church. Now, the reason we knew it was going to be a big church is not because we were arrogant, but because of this very important business principle that I want to share with you. In fact, this may be the price, be worth the price of the conference right here. If you have the only hot dog stand in town, your hot dogs don't have to be that good. Let me go over that for the A students, because this is kind of us B students, we're all over this, all right? If you have the only hot dog stand in town, your hot dogs don't have to be that good. Now, the reason we knew that we were gonna have a large and growing organization is not because we were gonna have the only church in town, but we were gonna have the only kind of church like our church. So if anybody in our town wanted to come to the kind of church we created, we were their only choice. And so sure enough, we grew quick. And before I knew it, I was just knee deep, waist deep, hip deep, you know, shoulder deep, neck deep, and all kinds of complexity as our organization grew and grew and grew. And it occurred to me that if I wasn't careful, I was gonna succumb to the complexity and lose sight of the clarity that's absolutely necessary to move an organization forward. So one day, I sat down at my desk. We bought all our furniture. Any of you who started an organization, you totally get this. You know, you have to have furniture, but you don't have any money. So there was a group that had sold all the furniture they could sell for their company because they're going out of business. And after they'd sold everything, they were about to leave it somewhere, and we caught them just before they left it somewhere. That was our furniture. You've been there, done that. You know, you open the drawer and there's initials and gum and, you know, bad words and, you know, all kind of stuff carved. And if you have a church, you really don't want bad words carved into your furniture. But anyway, so I'm sitting at my desk, just overwhelmed. You've been there. Some of you are there now. Just overwhelmed with so many demands, so much going on. I thought, I've got to keep this simple. I've got to create something. There's got to be something I can keep my eye on that allows me to move forward and not lose sight of what it is we're trying to do. So I jotted down three things. This is 18 years ago. And these three things, I had on three little 3x5 card. I remember I wrote it in red ink. I don't know why. It's the only pen I could find was in red. And every time I moved offices, I would carry this 3x5 card with me. And so for 18 years, this has been kind of the North Star for me, because as a person who has a difficult time with complex things, it's important for me to make things simple. So when I heard that LeaderCast was gonna focus on the idea of simplicity and leading simply, I thought, I know exactly what I wanna talk about. Because for people like me, and maybe people like you, we have to keep things simple. And no matter how smart you are, this is important, no matter how smart you are, as things become more complex, you need a way to keep your leadership simple. You need a place that you can retreat to in the point of crisis. You need a place where you can close your door, shut everything out, tell your assistant, I'm not taking any calls, and I've got to, this is important, recenter myself as a leader if I'm going to be able to move the organization forward in light of all the complexity surrounding this growing organization. So I'm going to give you what I wrote down on my 3x5 card, talk about it for a few minutes, and then we'll transition into the next session. Now, don't laugh if you say, well, that's simple. Of course it's simple. It has to be simple, because for people like me, I've got to keep it simple if we're going to keep things moving. So here they are, three questions. What are we doing? Why are we doing it? Where do I fit in? What are we doing? Why are we doing it? Where do I fit in? Let's just, at all of our sites, if we could, just humor me and let's read these out loud together. You ready? Here we go. What are we doing? Why are we doing it? Where do I fit in? One more time. What are we doing? Why are we doing it? Where do I fit in? Number one, what are we doing? Now, the last thing you need to start your day is a lecture on mission statements. You've sat through those before and you've heard people talk about how important mission statements are, but I gotta say this. 24 years ago, and 25 million copies ago, Stephen Covey, in his book, Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, talked about the value of mission statements. And I was one of those poor souls that when the book came out, thought, I gotta have the book, bought the book, read the entire book, marked it up. Many of you have multiple copies of his book, hopefully. But in his book, if you'll remember, and his whole talk about mission statements, the whole idea of coming up with one thing that drives an organization, that's kind of the North Star for an organization, he talked about the Ritz-Carlton Company. You probably remember this. At that time, my dad was a friend of Bill Johnson who owned the Ritz-Carlton Company. He's a resident here in Atlanta. And so through my dad, I was able to meet Bill and Sandra. Sandra's his wife. My wife's name's Sandra. So we had this magic connection through the names of our wives. I'm not sure why that worked. And we became friends. So one afternoon, we were driving somewhere, and I turned to Bill, who's a very successful guy, very wealthy guy. And I said, Bill, I'm reading Seven Habits. Stephen Covey says at the Ritz-Carlton that even the bellmen have a mission statement. I'm thinking, how can I? And I said, Bill, really? I mean, is that really the bellman? I mean, the bellman have a mission statement? How do you get somebody at that level in the organization to embrace the idea of one simple thing that's going to drive their job description? He said, the only way to understand that is to go to our training for maids, cooks, and bellmen. I said, so you have a training for maids, cooks, and bellmen? He said, yeah, would you like to attend our training for maids, cooks, and bellmen? I said, I absolutely would. So me and a couple of buddies loaded up, and we went and spent 2 days at Ritz-Carlton in Buckhead and went through the training for maids, cooks, and bellmen. I didn't learn a thing about cooking or making a bed or standing at a door, but I learned something extraordinarily important in those 2 days, that there is extraordinary power and there is extraordinary clarity that comes into any job or any environment when you reduce it down to the one thing that has to be done and you're able to answer the question, what are we doing? And I wish I had time to tell you about those 2 days because they were extraordinary, but it just imprinted on me as a young leader that if wherever you are and whatever you're doing, you need to be able to answer the question quickly and simply, what are we doing? Because answering that question brings clarity in an environment that's extraordinarily complex. You've heard the answer to the question for the maids and the bellmen and the cooks at the Ritz-Carlton Company. I sat there as Horst Schulze, who's a German, who was leading that team that day and leading the training, another Atlanta resident, incredible guy. As he helped this group of people, many of them couldn't even speak English, had translators, helped this group of people embrace the simple idea that you've heard before, that we are ladies and gentlemen serving ladies and gentlemen. We are ladies and gentlemen serving ladies and gentlemen. No matter what happens, no matter how chaotic things get at the hotel, no matter how, you know, quickly things have to be served in the restaurant, no matter how crazy things get, just remember this. Here's what you're here for. You are ladies and gentlemen serving ladies. And I watched a group of people who had probably been through very little training in their whole lives rise to the occasion and begin to embrace the idea. As he said, you are not servants. You are ladies and gentlemen serving ladies. And gentlemen, after 2 days, I walked out and I thought, for the rest of my life, I want to be able to answer succinctly, what am I doing? And I want everybody who ever answers to me in any organization I'm involved in to be able to answer succinctly and simply, what am I doing? Here's the problem. The mist in your mind will eventually become a fog in your organization. If it's not absolutely clear to you and you're not able to say it in a way that's portable and in a way that's memorable, what are you doing? What are we doing? That mist, that little bit of lack of clarity in your mind, it becomes a fog for everybody who's working for you. Or I could say it this way. If you don't know exactly what you're doing, if you don't know exactly what you're doing, you're gonna have a difficult time doing it. People who make bees like statements like that, you know? If you don't know exactly what you're doing, now again, all of us, and we all know the big famous, you know, industry standard war stories. We all heard the story of Steve Jobs coming back to Apple in 1980, or 1998, or 1997, whenever it was. Walks back at Apple and everything's chaotic, you know the story. Extraordinary complexity as they went in lots of different directions in terms of products and markets. And he walks in, you remember this story? He walks in and he announces this. He says, "We're gonna make easy to use computers." What are we doing here? We're gonna make easy to use computers. Well, we're doing this project over here. Does it have anything to do with easy to use computers? No, we're gonna stop doing that. Walked into one of the most complex business, one of the most complex industries, one of the most complex companies in one of the most complex industries, and with a simple idea, the ability to answer the question, what are we doing, took that incredible company and made it even more incredible. So here's a difficult question. In fact, here's a question that you're gonna need to, as a leader, wrestle to the ground, and you're gonna convince yourself that it's not possible. But I'm telling you it is. What are you doing? What are you doing? Because when things are going crazy and the demands are high and there are people who want your attention and there's more work than can ever be done and you're ignoring your family because there's so much to do at work, you need to be able to retreat to the one simple idea. What are we doing? Now, I'll tell you why you don't have a simple answer to that question. You just haven't worked on it long enough. And you would push back and say, "Andy, you don't understand our industry." You're right, I don't. "Andy, you don't understand my company." You're right, I don't. "Andy, you don't understand my demands." You're right, I don't. But that's not why you don't have a simple answer to the question, what are you doing? You don't have a simple answer to the question, what are you doing? Because you have not worked on it long enough. But when you find it, when you find the common denominator, when you are able to tell yourself and everyone who reports to you, "Hey, take a deep breath and let's remember, what are we doing?" That type of simplicity cuts through the complexity and brings the clarity that every organization and every organizational leader needs. Number two, why are we doing it? Why are we doing this? What are we doing? Why are we doing this? Now, this is where the emotion of your job is. This is where the emotion of what you've been called to do. This is the emotion of why you took the job. This is where you begin to connect the dots. This is where things become inspiring. This is where you find the motivation to get up and do it again, go back to work, have another meeting, make another call, and keep things moving forward. Why are we doing what we're doing? This is the statement that begins with because, in light of, if we don't. This question answers the question, what would happen in your community if your company ceased to exist? What would happen in our country if your industry ceased to exist? What would happen in your community, your town? What would happen with the thousands of people that are part of your company? What would happen if we didn't do what we're here to do? Now, when you hear something like that, I mean, I'm thinking, you think, well, Andy, if you're in like a nonprofit world, that's easy. I mean, if you're digging wells, that's easy. If you're feeding hungry children, that's easy. If you're, you know, if you're building houses for people who need homes, that's easy. But Andy, we sell things. We manufacture things. We just provide a service. I don't know that there's anything inspirational. I don't know that the answer to this question is gonna be that helpful. And I want you to know you're wrong. And here's how I know that. Because I know something about your company. Once upon a time, your company didn't, was an idea. And if we could go back in time and sit in the room with the people who had the idea and begin thinking about raising the capital, putting their own money into this idea, if we would have paused in the middle of this question, why are you doing this? Why are you risking your own capital? Why are you gonna chase down an idea that might not work? Why would you begin a company that's trying to answer a question that no one's ever been able to answer? Why are you doing this? Chances are you would hear from the founders of your company a compelling reason why, which tells me this about your company. Somewhere back in there, somewhere in the midst of all the complexity, is a compelling reason as to why you're doing what you're doing. And to cut through the clutter and the complexity that haunts every single organization, that overshadows every single organization. There is a compelling answer to the question why that harnesses, this is so important, that harnesses the hearts of the people who are leaning in and who have committed to your organization. Why are you doing what you're doing? If you lose sight of the answer to this question, or if you've never answered it, this is where you lose your motivation and it just becomes a job. But worse than that, if the people who report to you and work for you don't have a good answer to that question for them, it just becomes a job. And you may view yourself as a leader of a team, but the people who report to you don't feel like team members. They feel like employees. So what are you doing? Why are you doing it? What are you doing? Why are you doing it? And then the third question, where do I fit in? Now, where do I fit in? I'm not talking about your job description. All right, if you've worked anywhere for more than 2 weeks, you can't even find your job description. Isn't that the case? If you've worked where you work for 2 years, your job has changed so many times that your job description is irrelevant. There's probably not one person listening or online, anybody at any of our sites or in the room, because you're leaders, who has ever pulled out your job description in the middle of the day and gone, oh yeah, what am I doing? I mean, you got that at your interview, right? And they handed it to you. You have no idea where it is. So I'm not talking about your job description. What I'm talking about is this. This is so important. In light of what you're doing, whether it's your division, your department, your company, your branch, your entire industry, in light of what you're doing, in light of why you're doing it, where do you fit in? Specifically, what's your critical role? What's the thing that if you don't do it, it doesn't get done, and if you do it well, it almost doesn't matter what else doesn't get done? What is your unique contribution? In light of what you're doing as a company, in light of what you're doing as an organization, what is your unique contribution? Where do you fit in? Where are you critical? Number three, what is your core responsibility? What is your core responsibility? So on my little 3x5 card, I've kept these questions in front of me for over 18 years. What are we doing? Oh yeah. Why are we doing it? Oh yeah. Andy, where did you fit in? What is your core responsibility? What is it that only you can do? Andy, what is it that you've got to do? And if you do that well, everything else works out. And if you spend your time doing all these periphery things, it doesn't really matter. What are we doing? Why are we doing it? Where do I fit in? Now, here's the important thing. In your organization, whether it's division, department, branch, whatever it is, in your organization, the answer to those first two questions are the same for everybody. And if you're a good leader, everybody that answers to you should be able to answer that question quick. And if you're a great leader, they'll all answer it the same way. What are we doing? Everybody knows. Why are we doing it? Everybody knows. But when it comes to this third question of where do I fit in, this is where things get interesting. So I want to encourage you to do something that is going to be very, very time consuming. But it may be one of the most helpful exercises you ever work through as a leader, especially as it relates to understanding your critical role in light of what you're doing and why you're doing it. And that is to create for you and to create for your direct reports. And then I would encourage you to expand even beyond that. As you think about the critical players in your company or your division or your department, even if they don't answer to you, to create a one sentence job description. Now here's why that's important. Because it's simple. Because in the midst of the complexity, in the midst of the crisis, in the midst of the deadlines, everybody needs to understand and everybody needs to know what you think their critical role is in the midst of the organization. If you do not clarify this for people who report to you, they will do generally whatever comes next and whatever they feel like you think is most important in the moment. So years ago, I sat down and did this. I have three direct reports that are my management team. I communicate about 35 times a year in our weekend services. So a big part of my time is spent preparing content to keep people awake for 35 minutes. In fact, it's interesting, in my industry, if you can keep people awake for 35 minutes, they put you in charge of the whole organization. I'm not sure that's whether you have any leadership skills or not. It's a terrible model, but we've been stuck with it for about 2,000 years. So anyway. So I sat down and I asked the question, okay, so I think about my direct reports and then I have about 14 people that are part of a leadership team. You may call it a management team. And I sat down, it took hours and hours. In fact, it took several days, you know, working a little bit of time every single day to come up with and to answer the question, okay, when in case of emergency, you know, break the glass, pull the lever, what's the one thing everybody who's in charge of any important part of this organization, what is their one sentence job description? So I want to give you a couple of examples. This is so time consuming. And when you see mine, I'm not giving you mine to copy. In fact, our industries are so different. Most of my job descriptions, one sentence job descriptions, would be irrelevant in your context. But essentially, this exercise brought such clarity. So for example, here's mine. My one sentence job description: to inspire our staff and congregations to remain fully engaged in our mission and strategy. To inspire our staffs and congregations to remain fully engaged in our mission and strategy. When there's clutter, when there are demands, when the schedule's crazy, when I'm just not even sure which pile to look into, I retreat to, okay, Andy, what's your critical role? What are you here to do? Oh, yeah. Inspire staff and congregation to be fully engaged in our mission, our strategy. Here's our chief financial officer's one sentence job description. His name's Rick Holiday. To create, implement, and monitor systems that ensure our organization remains fiscally secure. That sentence took me about 2 hours. You know why? Because his job is so broad. I mean, we have 5 big churches here. We got 25 churches. We got TV. We got podcasts. I mean, our organization has gotten so complex. And all the financial part of that funnels into his office and through his part of the organization. So I sat down, I said, Rick, look, if things get crazy, when things get fuzzy, when the complexity begins to overwhelm you and overwhelm the organization, here's what I need from you. Create, implement, and monitor systems that ensure our organization remains fiscally secure. In case of emergency, break that glass, read that statement. That's your critical role in this organization. Now I'm going to show you my administrative assistant's one sentence job description. Now, honestly, I thought about charging extra for this. If you have an administrative assistant, you're going to love this. But here's what's interesting. Diane, who is here today, knew that I was working on these one sentence job descriptions for all these big, you know, division department heads. And she said, Andy, she said, I wrote my own. I said, you wrote your own one sentence job description? She said, yeah, what do you think? And she handed me a sentence and I thought, oh my gosh, look at this. Here's my administrative assistant's one sentence job description from my perspective. To keep my path clear of non-essential tasks and decisions so that I can do what only I can do. Woo! I thought I should have just charged extra for that. Isn't that amazing? So she comes to work, and I mean, you know how it is. If you're an administrative assistant, or you've got an administrative assistant, and everything kind of funnels through their office or through their computer or their cube or whatever it is. And she can come to work every day and say, in spite of all the clutter and all the complexity and all the demands, my job is simple. I'm going to keep all the non-essential tasks and decisions away from Andy so that he can do what only he can do. See, there's power. This is what I want you to understand. There is power in simplicity. And the more complex your industry is, and the more complex your job is, and the more complex your division, department, the demands are, the more important it is for you to find the simplicity, because every leader needs an escape hatch. Every leader needs a place to retreat to. Every leader needs a place where they can recenter and remind themselves of core things. And for me, it's those three things. The bottom line is this: growth and your leaders. So you're going to grow. Your leaders, so things are going to get bigger. Growth creates complexity. There is no way around it. There's no way to dodge that. Growth creates complexity, which requires simplicity. Growth creates complexity, which requires simplicity. So for me, it's these simple, three simple questions. What are we doing? Why are we doing it? Where do I fit in? What are we doing? Why are we doing this? Where do I fit in? So here's your homework. What are you doing? And don't say, oh, Andy, it's too complex. No. It's only complex because you haven't taken the time to answer the question. What are you doing? Is it possible that you could boil your extraordinary organization down to a simple break the glass, read the statement, get back in the middle statement? What are we doing? It may take some time. You may need some help. You may need somebody to sit down and talk you through this and talk you through this. But when you get there, it's gold. We're making easy to use computers. Any questions? Do you know what it is for us in our organization? We create churches unchurched people love to attend. That's it. Why'd you come to work today? We create churches unchurched people love to attend. That's it. Why are you doing it? Somewhere in your history, somewhere in your personal history, Somewhere back there, somewhere, there was a compelling reason for somebody to begin your company. There was a compelling reason for somebody to say, you know what? We need a new division in this company. We need a new department. We need to split these things out and let somebody wake up thinking about this. Somewhere back there, there was a compelling reason. You need to discover what it is, and everybody who works for you needs to understand that. And then, what's your core role? Where do you fit in? I'm just telling you. If you take the time to work through these three questions, you will have a simple approach to leadership that in times of crisis and in times of unavoidable complexity, it'll give you a place to go, and it'll give you clarity as you lead your team into your future. So, let's keep it simple. For some of us, we have to. For some of you, you will need to learn to. But either way, let's keep it simple. Hey, thanks so much for allowing me to be part of LeaderCast. Hope you guys have an extraordinary day. And hopefully we'll see you next year. Thank you very much.